great way to start the day with an applause, right? Every day. Anyways, thanks for coming out this morning. I actually had a bet with a couple folks Saturday morning if anybody would show up on college campus, but it looks like you guys are all great in the morning. Well, so when you look at the brochure, if you will, it talks about McDonald's three-legged stool. How do we have folks with competing interests work together and align? That's what we're going to talk to you about today. And so you just heard it. We have an owner operator, we have a corporation, and I represent the agency. So what we're going to do today is a couple things. We're going to talk about how we work together, give you an idea of what the three-legged stool means for McDonald's, and more importantly, our presentation is going to be not as long as others because we want to engage in conversation with you. So we want to have a panel at the end to make sure you can ask all the questions that you want to ask about marketing communications, about the brand, about how we work together. Okay? So there are a couple disclaimers, though. What you're going to see a lot is a lot of background stuff because McDonald's is a very proprietary and popular global brand, has a very strong legal department. Can I say that, James? So a lot of the text will not be in the presentation itself. So when you go back to the presentation, you'll see us talk about it. So ask the right questions. Okay, give you something to think about. All right, so moving forward, let's talk about this thing called the simple three-legged stool. I mean, simple construction, it's got three legs, got a brace in the middle, they all support each other, right? It's a cliche. You've heard it before. You need all three legs of the stool to be together, to have balance, for this to be successful, for it to hold up, whatever it wants to hold up. Hold up success, hold up to milk and a cow, if you had a bar, whatever it takes, they all need to work together. Cliche. For McDonald's, it's more than a cliche. It's part of the core values. One of the values says that we believe in the McDonald's system. That's one of the values. The McDonald's system is based off this idea of balance between the three legs. You need the brand itself, brand McDonald's. You need agency and suppliers to help supply the brand, and the owner operators to help execute. We're going to talk about those things today. Simple idea. Simple concept. Let's talk about how that comes to life. So the first leg of the stool, the McDonald's brand.
Great. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So I get to talk about the brand and the corporate side a little bit. And, you know, when you think about a company the size of McDonald's, as Mel just went through, it takes a lot.
What a great way to start the day with an applause, right? Every day. Anyways, thanks for coming out this morning. I actually had a bet with a couple folks Saturday morning if anybody would show up on college campus, but it looks like you guys are all great in the morning. Well, so when you look at the brochure, if you will, it talks about McDonald's three-legged stool. How do we have folks with competing interests work together and align? That's what we're going to talk to you about today. And so you just heard it. We have an owner operator, we have a corporation, and I represent the agency. So what we're going to do today is a couple things. We're going to talk about how we work together, give you an idea of what the three-legged stool means for McDonald's, and more importantly, our presentation is going to be not as long as others because we want to engage in conversation with you. So we want to have a panel at the end to make sure you can ask all the questions that you want to ask about marketing communications, about the brand, about how we work together. Okay? So there are a couple disclaimers, though. What you're going to see a lot is a lot of background stuff because McDonald's is a very proprietary and popular global brand, has a very strong legal department. Can I say that, James? So a lot of the text will not be in the presentation itself. So when you go back to the presentation, you'll see us talk about it. So ask the right questions. Okay, give you something to think about. All right, so moving forward, let's talk about this thing called the simple three-legged stool. I mean, simple construction, it's got three legs, got a brace in the middle, they all support each other, right? It's a cliche. You've heard it before. You need all three legs of the stool to be together, to have balance, for this to be successful, for it to hold up, whatever it wants to hold up. Hold up success, hold up to milking a cow, if you had a bar, whatever it takes, they all need to work together. Cliche. For McDonald's, it's more than a cliche, it's part of the core values. One of the values says that we believe in the McDonald's system. That's one of the values. The McDonald's system is based off this idea of balance between the three legs. You need the brand itself, brand McDonald's. You need agency and suppliers to help supply the brand, and the owner operators to help execute. We're going to talk about those things today. Simple idea, simple concept. Let's talk about how that comes to life. So the first leg of the stool, the McDonald's brand.
Great. Good morning, everyone. So, I get to talk about the brand and the corporate side a little bit, and you know, when you think about a company the size of McDonald's, as Mel just went through, it takes a lot of folks working on that and working together to achieve what we're trying to achieve and to be a restaurant that can not only serve our customers, but can also serve our communities and the industry and make changes that we've done over several years. So I'll show you in a moment, if you could put the slide out, our mission statement, and without trying to sound too corporate here, but our mission is to be our customers' favorite way and place to eat and drink. So every day we come to work, we think about how can we do this. Beyond that, though, it's so much more than that we work on every day. It is how we can be a strong, positive presence in our communities. 90% and going up to 95% of our restaurants are owned by local franchisees who live and work in their individual communities. And I'm sure growing up, you probably know many of the franchisees that operate within your communities. They support local Boy Scouts, they support your schools, they support, you know, football teams, softball teams. So it is really a testament to the brand of how we work. We also, you know, want to be a great place for our crew. Almost 50% of first jobs come from McDonald's. We have a ton of people who come and work their way through McDonald's. I'm an example of someone who started in the restaurants when I was 16 years old. So when we said, you know, I started working in a restaurant, my franchisee, someone like Jeff introduced me to an agency where I interned, got that job, and have now worked my way up to the point where I'm the director of 700 restaurants in marketing for the state of Ohio. So there's tremendous opportunity within McDonald's to help not only to start a career, but to grow a career. So we're very proud of the skills that we're teaching our crew and the opportunities that we provide. So with that, I'm going to hand it over, I think, to Jeff. He's going to talk a little bit about the operator side of the three-legged stool. Jeff.
Well, good morning, everybody.
Yeah.
I want you to know that my wife and I drove over yesterday. We took care of a few cicadas for you. As we were driving through. We couldn't figure out what was hitting our windshield, and it must be the state bird. But anyway, the three-legged stool is really a great analogy of McDonald's. And if you think of it this way, is that the way I look at it is we all have our part in polishing our part of the art. Okay? And so let me give you just a little bit on the owner-operator side. So again, my name is Jeff Montfort, but together with my wife, we own and operate 6 restaurants in Northwest Ohio. But beyond that, we also, it's a family business, because our 3 grown children are part of our business as well. 2 of them are actually owner-operators as well. So it's kind of neat to see a generational thing. In our story, even though in a way it's unique, it's very common, as James already pointed out. Ours is unique in that we began our McDonald's journey in 1972. And believe it or not, in my wallet, I still have my first paycheck stub in 1972, and I can show that to you later. That's my story, that really that minimum wage does not mean minimum opportunity, because there's plenty of opportunity. So so our story is unique in that we started, met at McDonald's, so we're both 16 years old. We're 16 years old. We meet at McDonald's. first job. We fall in love with each other. We fall in love with the business and the rest of the system. So it's kind of, if you think about it this way, we really believe that, you know, if you believe this, we believe we actually have a little bit of ketchup in our veins. So let me give you there, beyond that, just some, my perspective as far as McDonald's part of the three-legged stool. So again, we all polish our part of the arch. It is a partnership between the suppliers and agencies and the corporation. It's a great partnership that's worked for many years. So, but from our perspective, from my point of view, from an owner-operator, I would say this, is that, again, we're interdependent with each other, but our part of the marketing piece is pretty simple. Our job is to run great restaurants. Honestly, I mean, that's the best marketing tool anybody can have. We know that. And so that's really the best thing that we can do. We have from the foundation of Ray Kroc, you might have even heard QSCMV, and that stands for quality, service, cleanliness, and value. And those foundational principles that Ray set out with back in 1955 are the same ones. Even though the system has changed over the years, those things have not changed, and it's still the foundation of all that we do. So really, from the owner-operator side of the view, from marketing, these guys take care of a lot of the outside things. When it comes to marketing, the agency, they take care of outside things. Our job is to take care of what I call inside the curb. You know, when you come in, you drive onto the parking lot. I mean, everything we want is to point to the marketing and the promotional and all the money we've spent in marketing. We want to make sure that when you drive on that lot, when you walk in the doors, it's all pointing towards that marketing and the promotion. To me, it's kind of like a wedding. You go to a wedding, and all of the wedding points to the one thing, that bride going down the aisle, right? Everybody turns and they follow, you know, that. And that's the way I look at it from the owner-operator point of view. All that we do supports and promotes what we're trying to do marketing. And so I'll say this too, is that there's a credibility piece, and we want to make sure that what that consumer sees in the marketing ad, when they walk into the restaurant, that's what we deliver. It's always a challenge, but that's the goal. So that's one thing from the owner-operator perspective, and then the other thing I would say, and James already alluded to it, is that McDonald's is largely local small business folks. A lot of people look at McDonald's and they see this global giant company, but honestly, it's a small business. You know, it's a family business like ours. And we love being in the communities where we do business. So we have six communities. We just love that part of it. So even though we're a global company, you can think globally, but you can still act locally. And that's really, I think, the owner-operator side of things. So, and think about this, the owner-operator's input when it comes to marketing and integrated marketing, if you will. Think about this. I thought of this last night. It was actually, many of our products have been developed by owner-operators. But yet, then we come to our folks here, and then they develop them. So not far from here in Pittsburgh, Jimmy Delagatti, you know, developed the Big Mac. Okay? Lou Grown in Cincinnati, Ohio, listening to his customers during the Lent season, developed the Filet-O-Fish sandwich, my favorite sandwich, by the way. And then you can go beyond that. Herb Peterson in California developed the Egg McMuffin back in 1972 when I started. And now look, we're serving breakfast all day. So really, that's my message. We're all about polishing our part of the arch. Okay, and that's our part as the inside the curtains, if you will, doing our best to make sure that that credibility that you see and hear in marketing goes all the way down to the restaurant level at the point of sale. So with that, I think I'm turning back.
Absolutely. Thanks, Jeff. So the last leg of the stool, supplier partners. So I'm going to speak on behalf of all supplier partners, and that means everybody from the potato farmers in Idaho to the folks who are developing our equipment to our advertising agencies. We're all there to do one thing, to make sure that the brand that we supply the brand to deliver what the operators need to serve consumers, customers. Whatever that may be. That may be from marketing communications, to the right potato, to the right equipment. And that's what our suppliers do. Now, McDonald's, if you know McDonald's, over the years, they've been known to have great long-term relationships with their suppliers. It's a well-known fact and legend. Ray Kroc signing basically a handshake deal with Coca-Cola, and then been the only sort of provider for many, many years, and there's still not a legal contract from Coca-Cola. There's no exclusive contract legally. That's still on a handshake. That's the relationship that the suppliers have. Our suppliers are long-term relationships. We've been a McDonald's advertising agency for over 40 years throughout the United States. So that's the kind of relationship that McDonald's has with their suppliers going forward. Our role as an advertising agency, and more importantly, as a local advertising agency, we'll get into the difference here in a second, our role is to make sure that we connect the brand to the consumer. I know this is a marketing communications conference. I wanted to make sure that told you kind of the benchmark, if you will, the basis of the McDonald's and how it works. How it works, we're going to talk about more from a marketing perspective, and as we get closer to the end, we'll talk more about marketing communications and our roles there. So I'll get to blab on and on and on. And then your questions, of course, will help us take care of the issues that you want to talk about. So how it works? Well, you heard about it. It's a global company, global entity, but it really operates from a local perspective. When you look at this, look at the right side, Global McDonald's USA, Regional and Co-op, that is the business line, if you will. That's what your organization is made up. It's really, should be another level, and it should be restaurants underneath that. Going up, owner-operators with different restaurants, they get together to form a co-op, and I'll talk about what a co-op is in a second. And from a co-op, that group works together, and they hire us. We'll talk about that in a second as well. As you go up, the regional, that's where James represents a territory that works together to help make sure we bring what we need to the consumers and make sure the restaurants run properly. And then you have the brand itself and then the global brand. So, the relationship from a marketing perspective, you see that thing called OpNet? What that is a national group of operators that vote our marketing program. I should have said at the title, you have the global company, hometown brand, and democratic governance. Literally, marketing programs do not happen without the operator's vote and McDonald's brand approval. So national agencies, local agencies, we have to vote, influence, support, and develop plans that both entities, the other two legs of the stool, need to support. So from a national perspective, we have about 180 people in a room, about 54 operators that vote on the national programs. From a local perspective, the field agency, that's us, we work with our local cooperatives. Some co-ops have 17 operators, some have two. But they vote on how things work. So from our perspective, what we have to think about as a field agency, first thing is first, who pays us? McDonald's corporate doesn't pay us. Sorry, James.
No, I'm glad I don't.
Jeff and his cohorts, they hire us to connect the brand to their customers so they can make money. So they're the ones that hire and fire us as local agencies. Now, don't get me wrong, the master brand, McDonald's, has a lot to say because they have a lot to say who's an owner-operator, thus hiring us. Kind of, going around in circles there. But we know where our bread's buttered with the customers coming to a restaurant. So the next step is, but they hire us, our job is to deliver and align with James and regions and marketplaces and the brand to do what we just said, deliver the customers to consumers in that marketplace. So they have governance, if you will. They have to approve everything that we do in the local marketplace. And even more impactful to us is the legal creative approval from the brand governance or the brand folks at US or global. It doesn't make any sense to protect this brand if you let local agencies go do whatever they want to. So everything we do is connected to the national piece. So when you talk about how you work together, why it takes so long to get something done, Well, you can see that the process itself is, one, we have to figure out how, what we want to do. We have to convince our owner-operators that this is something they need to do. We need to work with the brand and say, can we do this? And they say, yes, if it's in our overall strategy within our area. And then we have to get the approval from the brand itself that we're not taking the brand in a place it doesn't belong. Now, there are some things that have snuck in the past, and some of you guys have seen them, I'm sure, some of these goofy commercials that get pulled off right away. Those agencies normally aren't around after that for a while. But in reality, it happens, because I'll get into this next year. The next thing is the question is a co-op. So what happens is that we talk about all these operators get together to form a cooperative. So the co-op decides what they want to market, what they want to do underneath the overall strategy. So I'm going to say it like this. For those of you, how many of you actually had an antenna TV? Raise your hand. Wow, it's a lot more than I thought. I feel so much better. So back in the day, for you youngsters, when we had antenna TV, Arbitron, now Nielsen, helped define what we called area of dominance influence. Now it's designated market area, ADIs and DMAs. A lot of you market folks know that. And really, that's because at the time, it's where the antenna can reach. So what you would do, what we would do as a marketer, we would get the groups together to help fund the marketing plan, a cooperative. You have that with the milk cooperatives, farmer cooperatives, you name it. It happens all the time. But from McDonald's owner operators, that's what they would do. And it was defined by that area of dominant influence, or now DMAs. Okay, so back then, very much needed, because you could only buy that local TV, print and so on, and you would deliver your message, and your message was somewhat protected against the rest of the nation. For example, right now, we're at Barton Morgantown, we're actually in the Pittsburgh DMA, right? Of course, you're right next to the Clarksburg Western, you're right here on the border, so you probably get both. But the decision would have been made by the Pittsburgh group on what they advertise in this marketplace back in the day. And the bleed over would be small. So what has happened? Evolution, real life, you know, social media, cable, national cable, you know, digital, audio on digital, video on digital, you name it. The DMAs aren't as relevant anymore, except for organizations, for organizational purposes. Because I can sit in my home, my basement in Columbus, Ohio, and buy for any market anywhere in the world. I couldn't do that 30, 40 years ago. So I'm telling you that because as you go into the communications world right now, cooperatives and DMAs may not be relevant to you, and they shouldn't be. Because if you're looking about setting a marketing plan, the reality is, if you're sitting right here in Morgantown, somebody in Columbus can connect with your ad. Somebody in San Diego will connect with your ad because it's probably on digital. You can geofence, you do whatever you want, but somebody's going to connect. If not, social media will take it out of your marketplace. Right? So those are the challenges that we have to look at as an agency going forward. We'll talk about that at the end. But the cooperatives were made because of that simple challenge. Now what happens for us is that we have to look beyond that. But our owner-operators don't, because they live in that DMA. They live in that co-op. They fund the advertising that's going to happen in that cooperative. They pay us to help support driving customers in that marketplace. So we have to find ways to do that without damaging our connections across the U.S. So why are cooperatives, co-ops still here? But the co-ops are still here for the operators, for them to manage each other and manage their budget. That's what happens. So basically, the Pittsburgh budget, Clarksburg Weston, they'll get together, they'll get their budget, decide what they're going to spend, help us drive the business, and from there, we figure out the best way to do that. Nationally, it's not as big of a problem. Nationally, you can do whatever you want. You don't care about the beat over at that point, because you're going to talk to all consumers. So that's one of the challenges, and I mentioned that because, and I said I wouldn't say this, but I am going to. It is a very archaic system that we're dealing with here. So we're taking a heritage brand and an old system and trying to deliver it in a contemporary way. that's going to be your challenge when you're dealing with guys like us or any established brand as you go forward. If the system is archaic based on TV, any system based on TV now is going to be archaic. Don't get me wrong, TV is still important, blah, 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 you're all that. But it can't be based on that as the foundation. So anyway, so I wanted you to know that because it's a challenge that we have. Co-ops comes up all the time, and the co-op is still an important part of McDonald's business because it's an organizational and budgeting and planning factor. And so that's, as communication folks, you need to know to go forward. Okay, so let's talk about how we work as a part of the three-legged stool. You saw national to local, but you have three different legs of the stool, and we have different needs sometimes. And let's talk about, from an operator's perspective, how we can.
Okay, so one thing I would say right from the start is from structure comes size. Now think about that for a minute. Think about the global size of McDonald's, and it needs structure. So some of the archaic structure you see there is necessary, just as you would need a good structure to build a big skyscraper, yes? So let me set this up for you then how this works. So. I'm going to give you a co-op example, and it's very personal to me because I happen to be the co-op president at the time when this came. So this is how it works from a co-op level. So I'll set it up, and then Mel, you're going to give them the result. So in 2011-2012, our co-op, which consists of about 74 restaurants in the Dayton, Ohio DMA or market. Okay, so we meet together monthly, and one of the challenges we were looking at was driving late night sales. Okay, we were struggling to penetrate that with other players already in there, and there's lots of messages out there. And what we found out was our message that we were delivering wasn't relevant enough, because what we were coming to them was just basically extending our regular menu after midnight, so to speak. You get what I'm saying here? So. The challenge was, how can we break through the clutter? And then the challenge we came to the agency and what we came them and charged them with was, what can we do? And the idea we came up with was breakfast after midnight. Does that sound familiar now? Okay. So the precursor to what you see right now with the breakfast all day, back in 2011 and 2012, we were actually sticking our toe in the water with this thought. But then again, now you see how the three-legged stool comes together, because it's not good enough just to have the idea, right? So then now the challenge then from the co-op then to the agency, and then also to McDonald's, because McDonald's had to approve, and we had to have to do a test market, okay? We got approved by McDonald's, so there's one leg of the stool right there. Then the agency has to be, we're looking for creative. That's why we hire them. We don't want them to come and say, well, what do you want to do? We want them to come to us and say, we want them to be as aggressive as they can. We'll tell them when to slow down, but we want them to come to the table. We want them to come to the table and tell us what they think we need to do, and we'll slow them down. So what you're going to see here as a result of the three-legged stool at its best, because it really works slick, and I'll let you take it from there.
Thanks, Jim. So again, the challenge was, okay, we want to reach a broader audience of late nights. Obviously, if you even have to do any research, you know that it's a lot of young folks at the time, millennial, 5 years ago, that's really partaking in a late night. And in fact, they keep telling us, if you would serve breakfast, I would be there. So that was a challenge. How do we do that? So what we're trying to do is trying to connect this craveability of breakfast, introduce breakfast, and try to add a connection point with millennials during the late night. We came up with this kind of theme, if you will, of nocturnivore. Basically, you're hungry at night, you're an omnivore, no, you're a late night nocturnivore. We actually had this great line with Big Mac in it, but
we said no. Not me.
So James would never say that. But so that's what he came up with. So basically, what I'm going to do is I'm going to run this video, just kind of talk about all the campaign elements and success. But really, what we had to do was create this idea, vet it through the region as well as the McDonald's brand several times. Because this was pushing it for the time. I'll say for a time. McDonald's is more aggressive now, but not so much then. So let me run this real quick. We'll go from there.
I love it!
McDonald's salutes not carnivores everywhere, serving breakfast after midnight. A limited breakfast menu in addition to your regular late night favorites.
If restaurants weren't meant to stay open late, they wouldn't have lights. Well, McDonald's does have lights, and they're staying on late, really late. For people like you who are just getting started when the grown-ups are tucking themselves in. Those whose hunger knows no curfew. The proud, the hungry, the nocturnivores. So go forth, savor the night. Secure in the knowledge that when the moon is full, you can be too.
Most locations open late. Participation varies.
Jumping, the place is packed, and when the crowd's like this, I'm ready to rap. But before I can put the rhyme on the mic, freaks are all over me like a white on wax. Freaks come in all shapes, sizes, and colors, but what I like about them most is that they're real good lovers. They do it in the dark, they do it in the dark, but most freaks are known for breaking hearts. You can never tell what a freak is thinking of, and you may never catch a freak without a beat one love. They don't walk, but they step, they strut, and nine times out of ten they drop.
Right, I'll leave the blank screen up for a second. So you notice that most of the executions were outside of the restaurant. Because again, at that time, millennials weren't coming to us, so we had to go where they were. So you saw all the different venues. And in this case, you saw the little pedicab in downtown Columbus. They call it Short North. Everybody has a little street where the bars and restaurants are. Without getting into the bars and restaurants, we were able to still communicate to those folks. So a lot of different ways of doing that, but that was allowed, if you will, from the brand itself and from the operators challenging us. Because you know agencies, we can do this at any time, right? We can be as crazy as we can be, but we have to be allowed to do that from a budgetary perspective as well as from brand governance. So this is something that worked. Obviously, McDonald's all day, there's no need for this anymore. We have to reposition this and be looking at doing something for late night. So let's talk about it from the brand perspective and some opportunities that may come that way.
So, great. So I'm gonna set up a little bit about a test that we did. So with any brand that's been around as long as us and that's as big as us, we have some, well, McDonald's is a brand, we actually have some items that are on our menu that can be categorized as billion-dollar brands. I mean, think French fries, think Big Mac, chicken nuggets. And if you've been around for 60 years, it's, with any company, it's how you're going to reinvent yourself, how you're going to bring some new life to something like a Big Mac that is maybe a little bit tired. We still sell a lot of Big Macs, right? I mean, but how can you sell more? How can you breathe some new life into that? And that's one of the challenges that we are facing as a company right now. Is while we're still selling 9 million Big Macs across the U.S., the trend line is going down. Younger people aren't eating Big Macs. We haven't found a way to reinvent it. So as we look at that challenge, and that's part of my job, part of the national job as the brand, is to identify those opportunities. We try to come up with, you know, ways to bring that to life. And again, this comes back to then, if we're going to do that on a national stage, we got to make sure we get it right in the restaurant. That's what Jeff mentioned earlier, right? How do we make sure it's delivered correctly? And we do that largely through test markets. And we go out and we ask our operators in a specific co-op to help us out. Let's put it in your restaurant for 3 months. Let's see how customers respond. Let's see how it works in the kitchen. So what you see on the screen here is a test that's currently happening right now in two markets across the U.S. It's in the Columbus market, and it's in the Dallas-Fort Worth market. And the idea was, can we bring some excitement and sort of cause an event around the Big Mac? And we did that through creating something we called the Junior Mac, which is just a smaller, it's actually a bigger patty than what you currently have on a regular hamburger, but it's slightly bigger. It's dressed like a Big Mac, so nothing really significant changed there, but just if you didn't quite want the size of a Big Mac, but we're looking for something great in that taste, we gave it to you. The other one was the Grand Mac, which was a significantly bigger sandwich. I prefer the Junior Mac, the Grand Mac is huge. But you know, the idea was, can we create this event? Can we drive some excitement? I'll tell you, early results are very strong. Customers are responding to both of these new products in the test markets. So with that, I would say, you know, probably be on the lookout for next year. I would expect this to kind of make its way into a national calendar. You'll probably see this across the country in 2017. And then I believe there's a creative spot here, and you'll see the creative spot, and this is where our agencies came into play and helped us out, was kind of this fun idea about what I just said. If a test isn't successful, we're not going to roll it out. So what we did in the creative was we asked customers, we took customers in non-test markets and had them plead for the test markets to make this successful so they could get it. So with that, I'll have you run this
one. I want that bigger Big Mac, Columbus.
Make it happen, people.
Central Ohio is now a test market for the new Mac Jr. and 1/3-pound Grand Mac. And if you show them the love, they may go nationwide.
You have the power, Columbus.
No pressure, though.
Thanks, James. That was a digital execution. Of course, the campaign was much broader than that. And so working with the national and as a local co-op, this happens quite a bit. We're test markets. Whenever you're test markets, either we originate it or the brand did, or in some cases, the operators asked for it as well. The next example is an example where we as an agency looked at consumer needs, and we asked the company, asked our operators to consider this going forward. We were actually looking at some of our southern markets, and this idea of chicken and waffles, come on, everybody loves it. Army griddles are well loved in a lot of ethnic markets as well as in the South because it's sweet, let's face it. Come on, I love it, let's go. But the idea of putting together chicken and waffles and making it successful for us, we wanted to test it out. So after going through our governance process, we're able to do that in some restaurants in Columbus. And I'm going to run a spot. This spot for you is Speckworth. Please understand it's not finished yet because we're still in a test. We haven't run the spot yet, but I'm going to run it for you, then I'm going to talk a little bit about it.
Mornings may not always be full of moments worth savoring. Fortunately, McDonald's is. Introducing the savory, sweet taste of the new Chicken McGriddles. A savory and spicy McChicken patty between sweet maple-infused McGriddles cakes. It's chicken and waffle taste with on-the-go eats. So stop in and savor a southern morning tradition.
So you hear the voiceover? So we took somebody from the marketplace itself and let them be natural. And so that's what you can do with the co-op, the local co-op. That's what you can do when you're creating something specific for your consumers in that marketplace. And what we do is try to communicate in that culture. And so that's what we have to try to bring to the conversation on an ongoing basis. What's right for the brand to the consumers in that marketplace? And this is just an example of what we do in one of our southern markets, which is not that far away, by the way. So just to get an idea, that these are just three different ways for us to work together just to create campaigns, create products, and connect consumers. We're going to talk a little bit more about the future here in a second. I just want to recap again. None of this happens without all of us. And in fact, that's another famous Ray Kroc saying. None of us is as good as all of us, right? And that's key, because when the balance is off, the results are terrible. We know that, we've seen that over the years. The other thing I'll tell you, this is one of the reasons why McDonald's has been successful for so long, because each of the legs hold each other accountable. I've had the pleasure, if you looked at my bio, to work for a lot of other QSRs, a lot of other restaurants in the past, and nobody has this model at all. It is a brand that drives the brand, and the operators that execute, they have no say in the brand itself. So what happens, you have a naturally strained relationship. This relationship, there's strain, there's stress, but there's also support for each other. Because they know they need each other, we need each other to be successful. And I said there's competing interests. You have McDonald's, basically they want to protect the brand, grow the brand, right? And they make their sales, they make their money off the top line sales. You have other operators, they're local, they're worried about their marketplace. Jeff, speaking for Jeff, he may care less what happens in San Diego, but he needs his marketplace to grow, right? And they make their money, like any other business, small business makes their money on the bottom line. We, on the other hand, are caught in between. We make their money by keeping the operators happy, making sure their business grows, and make sure that the brand doesn't hate us, so we can continue to grow too. So, but there's competing interests, and we represent the consumers in that competing interest conversation. And sometimes, what the brand wants, what the operator wants, and what the consumer needs, don't always meet in the middle. So our job is to find the best way to connect that and find the compromise that's necessary, or in some cases, push beyond the compromise. Okay, so let's talk about the future real quick, and then we'll get to Q&A. I think we're running a little bit faster than once.
You say we're...
No, we're good.
Let's okay. Start. So when we talk about future, this is the McDonald's vision statement. So earlier I went with the mission statement. This is the vision, and it is for us to become a modern and progressive burger and breakfast restaurant. So, you know, that sounds very corporate, and that's, you know, what vision statements are. But what I would say about that is, you know, I think that it means a multitude of things. I think from a food perspective, what you're going to continue to see, and hopefully if you're, you know, if you read about McDonald's or you hear about McDonald's, we're continuing to find ways to innovate in the food arena and to respond to what consumers are telling us. So whether that is, you know, we launched a new grilled chicken last year that took out artificial colorings and preservatives. We've been working with the World Health Organization on antibiotics and what we're doing to continue to improve our standard there. We've been leading the charge on getting more fruits and vegetables into our restaurants and making sure that we're providing that to kids and families and giving healthy options. So from a food standpoint, I think we're doing a lot to become modern and progressive. From a people standpoint, we're continuing to invest in our people and find ways to provide them with opportunities. So there's things such as, you know, we have a high school diploma program where we help our students move forward with that. We provide college tuition assistance. We have, you know, several restaurants that, you know, we have a lot of folks who English isn't their first language. We have programs that called English Under the Arches, which helps provide those employees with, you know, language classes free of charge to help them not only with McDonald's, but then to move on to whatever other careers they want to do. So I think being modern and progressive means a lot of things. And Mel mentioned, you know, earlier with how we're going to respond to customers and co-ops and the lines, I think technology is going to play a huge role in what it looks like in McDonald's to be modern and progressive. We just recently rolled out an application last year, the McDonald's app. Right now it's, you know, kind of tied to just offers, but where we see us going in the future with that is going to be really more one-to-one brand to consumer marketing. Because I think that is what people are looking for. If you're not a Big Mac buyer and all I'm advertising on television is Big Mac, then I'm not speaking to you as an individual. So I think we have a tremendous runway in front of us as a brand. With that, I'll hand it over to...
Absolutely. Because again, Jeff.
Yeah, and just the operator's vision for the future, I can sum it up really in a quote. I heard this quote actually from a Coca-Cola executive who came and spoke to us, and it is simple, but it's profound, and basically says this, you may have heard it before, it says that if you don't like change, you're gonna like irrelevance even less. Have you heard that before? I mean, but it's true. And I will tell you from our standpoint, we get it, okay? From operators, we understand. I've been around, I told you how long I've been around. But the good thing is we now have multi-generational owner operators, which is a great thing. I mean, watching our children in our business and seeing how they view it from their perspective is really very interesting. And we don't agree all the time, but it's interesting. But again, the structure you see is great, and we look forward to evolving as time goes. So,
thanks, Jeff. Why don't you go ahead and invite your wife, Mary, up?